Welcome, 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 geeks and nerds, girls and boys, to a brand new edition of Geek to Me Radio. Today, we are joined by DG Chichester talking all about his writing career for Marvel Comics and some other titles as well. We'll chat with him, and this will be the first part of a two-part long extravaganza. Stand by.
We're talking TV, comics and movies, and video games. Star Trek and Star Wars, we'll try to explain. There are 12 doctors, 4 Hogwarts houses, 1 ring rules and more. To be the greatest Pokemon master, you must catch them all. You must catch them all. Try to catch them all. Gotta catch.
And for those of you who have found us out there on the interwebs, we appreciate your subscribing, be it on Stitcher, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Podomatic, wherever you get your podcast from. We appreciate your finding and subscribing us there. If you've not already done so, we would love it if you would give us a 5-star glowing review. That always helps raise our profile in the search engines, and it would mean a lot to me. So if you could do that, I would greatly appreciate it. Also, make sure you check out YouTube. You can find Geek to Me Radio there. That way you can listen with it on in the background at work, or just have it on your iPhone and just kind of plug it in and listen to it that way too, if you'd prefer. All sorts of different ways, but we do appreciate your finding us and listening to us. We have a two-part episode going on. It'll be this episode and next episode. We had such a long and really rich conversation with writer DG Chichester that I was listening to it and couldn't find any good things to take out. It was a great interview. So we're going to make this a two-parter. We'll have another two-parter coming probably next month, and we'll get to more of that later. But right now, we're going to jump right to the interview. We're joined now by DG Chichester talking about his career working for Marvel. We'll get into a couple of other things too. DG, how are you?
I'm excellent. And you can go with Dan. Was a very pretentious type of thing I had to develop at one point because I was co-writing with somebody and I thought Daniel G. Chichester sounded too long, so I condensed it, which ended up sounding worse than anything else.
My middle name starts with a B. I always thought I should go by JB, but then I sound like a 1950s boardroom man with a big cigar, and I don't want to smoke cigars, so.
That works.
So talking about, I know you kind of, it almost sounds like you fell into comics a little bit backwards. You're going to school for filmmaking at New York University School. Was it just the New York U, or was it the School for Film up there?
It was the School for Film. It was what became the Tisch School of the Arts, the film program there, which was a great film program. And I had been, as a kid, deeply into comics in you know, the person who rode their bike every whatever it was, Tuesday, Wednesday, not to a comic book shop, but a local newsstand shop when they would get their comics in across a very busy road that I probably should have been riding along or down or across at that age. And every week would bring things home, mostly DC's, oddly enough, probably because of my initials. And then I at some point, and I had dresser drawers. I wasn't smart enough to have comic boxes or bags. I basically put all my clothes on the floor or in piles and took over every piece of furniture in my room to sort of stack these comics and did it forever until whatever it was. It feels like late preteens, maybe early teens. And for reasons I do not know, I just stopped. I kind of stopped cold, and it wasn't a disinterest. It wasn't a whatever. But then went to film school, as you said, and they're on the job board. In the student employment office was a ad for a typist at Marvel Comics. And I had just finished my junior thesis film. So it was, you put a lot of money into making your own film. NYU gives you a little bit and you're broke. Hmm. And so what do you do now? And I had been very fortunate. My parents had been able to sort of, take care of my college education. I did summer work. I was able to save up during that to, you know, buy my pizza slices and whatever else. But this one had really put a dent in a lot of things. And so I typist at Marvel Comics. Well, boy, I type really fast. And I used to know a lot about comics. And that sounds kind of fun. So, yes, you're right. In a way, it was like falling into it.
And you got to work for Jim Shooter. I know we've had Jim Shooter on the show before. Super nice guy. But a lot of people in the industry find him to be a bit of a contentious topic. Because some people hate him and some people love him. And I never understood. He sounds like one of the guys who made the trains run on time. But a lot of people kind of bristled at him. How did you find him to work with?
I really enjoyed Jim. And I had sent him a note a couple of years ago out of the blue and just sort of said that out loud. You know, I don't think I'd ever really said that to him in that way. And for whatever reason, I was struck by that. So when I went in for that job, I didn't get the job I went in for. It was actually a typist in the, if I remember correctly, the Foreign Rights Department. And they had just given it away. They just literally assigned the job to somebody who would come in, but they did me the dignity of giving me the interview. And they said, geez, you did a pretty good job. We don't have anything though. But Lynn Cohen, who was Jim Shooter's direct assistant, is looking for an assistant. So not the assistant to the editor-in-chief, but the assistant to the assistant to the editor-in-chief. So I went down, talked to Lynn, got the lay of the land, and I was still in school at this time. So it was going to be a part-time gig in the afternoons after I'd finished classes. And so I was sitting right outside Jim's office, right next to Lynn, and you can't get much closer to the sun than that. So my exposure to him was sometimes it was direct weird assignments. You know, he'd come out and say from a very, very tall height, I mean, I'm pretty tall, but Jim is taller, and I need a stuffed toy turkey for a prize for somebody. And in the pre-internet days or whatever, Jim Shooter says he wants a plush, you know, toy turkey. You go out to the streets of New York and you find somehow a plush toy turkey and those type of things. And other assignments would be answering the phone when somebody from Tennessee would call and want to know if could Spider-Man beat the Hulk. So you'd explain what might happen there. And occasionally you get little mini editorial assignments, like trying to not editorial assignments, but more paginating things, you know, putting page numbers on it. Very, very simple sort of things. But I would overhear things and Jim would be in the hallway and talking about things. And so there was a little bit of osmosis of learning from him. And I thought he was a terrific influence. There was a lot of contentiousness and I was not in that line of fire seeing him, you know, perhaps at odds with other editors or creators the same way a lot of people were. I'm not discounting that was going on. He was a big personality and had a big point of view about that. But in that direct relationship, I only sort of saw the good in a way. He seemed like he was very passionate about the characters. He would give what I felt was smart advice about changing this or changing that. And when I later went to work for Epic Comics, and I was working directly for Archie Goodwin, who was the editor-in-chief of that division, Jim would often come by and talk Epic Comics with Archie. And that, again, was a different relationship. His relationship with Archie was always very at the same level and respectful and sometimes even deferential in a way. So I think I saw a different side to him than others did. I'm very, very good friends with Greg Wright, who's a colorist and writer, from the same era. I'd help Greg get his job at Marvel at one point. And he had a different relationship. You know, he had good relationships, but he was also in that more, I'll say, direct line of fire.
Sure.
So he has a different view, probably more balanced, good and bad, you know, sort of thing. But I didn't see a lot of the rough edges maybe that some other people did.
I love that story because this is back in the 80s and you still had the Marvel bullpen. You were set up in New York. So people calling in, I can picture, you know, I'm not sure if you had access to an intercom, but can Spider-Man beat the Hulk? Please hold. Peter David, phone call on line two. Were you able to like patch anything through or did you feel those yourself?
I did feel them myself. And this kid, honest to God, he would call every single day. And I feel like it was probably before, you know, when we all took long distance calling for granted and it was sort of baked into your bill. So, and I know it was Tennessee because that was the area exchange and he had a bit of an accent. And I'm pretty sure I asked him once, because this kid called every day.
Wow.
Every day it was a different combination of characters. So it was, can Spider-Man beat the Hulk? Can Doctor Strange beat Captain America? Can Captain America beat Wolverine? It was maybe he was writing his own like early Wikipedia. I don't know. And I would try to answer it, but at some points the combinations were so ridiculous and the questions just kept going on. I would just put it on speakerphone. So everyone calling, coming by would hear it, and it sort of became known that around whatever it was, 3:30 or something every day, this kid was going to call. So we would have a little mini gathering of people out there, because my desk was right in the middle of the hall outside of Jim Shooter's office. And so we had this little mini laugh fest group conversation with this kid for quite a bit.
So some of the writers would actually come hang out and throw in their opinions on speakerphone? Was it kind of like
It was probably more editors. I mean, okay. Very, very rarely were, you know, I mean, writers were coming in and out, and you have to remember the structure of the Marvel offices then and perhaps now was a lot of your direct writers, artists were coming in to see their editors. They weren't based there in the office. So it was mostly the bullpen, which was all the production artists, and then the line editors, the line assistant editors, and so forth. So they would just be walking by and they would see me rolling my eyes or laughing or having this conversation. And what are you talking about? You know, what are you trying to explain? And I would, after a point, it got on to know that this kid was calling every single day.
Do you, like, just from the sound of his voice, was it like a young kid, like 7 or 8? Was it like a teenager? Do you have any idea at all? Did you get a name?
I can't remember a name if I did. I'm sure I probably did. I talked to him pretty much every day I was there. But it was my vision of him was always like a 14, 15-year-old kid. Okay. It sounded – he was articulate enough. He was deadly serious. I mean, it was really important for him to know who was going to win this battle. And you know, I'm sure at one point I probably recommended, well, there is the Handbook of the Marvel Universe.
Right.
You should pick that up. For ever and a day, he would give this call and then just one day stopped. So hopefully he got a body of knowledge and went on from there.
He, like you said, he may have created Wikipedia. He may have gone on to be the guy behind it. Who knows?
Exactly. Exactly.
And you worked on a lot of titles while you were at Marvel. You ended up working on, obviously, notably Daredevil. But while you were there, if I'm not mistaken, you got to write for just about at least a story for all the major characters, because I know you did solo Avengers, West Coast Avengers, Black Widow, Punisher, Cap, Spidey. Was there anyone you didn't get a chance to work on that you kind of feel you missed out?
You know, I did get a chance to work with a lot of titles, and it's the sort of thing that's funny when you put it that way. In the moment, you don't think about it as much, and you don't think about – I got to work with a lot of great artists, too. I mean, I was really fortunate. I worked with some people well above my talent rate, probably in some way, certainly above my page rate. And that was just a maybe lucky coincidence. And I never tried to take advantage of that or take that for granted. But between the work that I did on the print comics and then later I did a lot of the early digital comics from Marvel, you're right. I probably did touch a lot. I think I never had a chance to write the Hulk. I think that would have been a fun one to play with. I don't think I ever brought him into a story or played him out in a particular way. That's always been one of the ones that sort of stuck out in my head that would have been a great one to play with more. And I think I would have liked to play a little bit more with Spidey at one point or another in a more direct way. I got to play assistant editor on, I think, the first Spider-Man graphic novel, which was a Bernie Wrightson thing called Hookie. I won't even say it's editor. That's assistant editor. That's way too much. It was more of a production assistant help on it. But it was one of those projects that was near and dear to Jim Shooter's heart. And I remember sitting at that desk out in that hallway, going through, doing a lot of production work on it. And then later on, got to write a couple of instances of Spidey in some Daredevil stories. But I should have taken more advantage of my relationship with Danny Fingeroth or some of the other Spider-Man editors and said, hey, I got an idea, and raised my hand. But I always ran hot and cold between feeling like I know what I'm doing and I'm too nervous to talk to so-and-so.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just when you, like you said, when you think about it, there were so many that you worked on. You got to work on DC as well. A couple titles for them when you were doing more freelance stuff. You got to work on the Milestone titles. Which they're seeing a huge resurgence now.
And well deserved. Yeah.
Yeah. It was just, we had Dennis Cowan on the show last year talking about some of the milestone titles, and it's
awesome.
He's obviously very thrilled that people are finding those comics again and that they're enjoying such a popularity. Of all the titles you worked on, Marvel, DC, because I'm a huge fan of the TV show Sliders. You got to work on that comic series. Was there anything, it's easy to say Daredevil, I guess, but is there any one of the titles that you really feel like this was my best work? I loved working on this book the most, a favorite, something like that?
We're going to take our first break. Come back. Chatting more with DG Chichester. Stand by.
With the power of a bull.
Ain't no monster clown who is as lovable
as ever loving Hulk. Hulk, Hulk.
Hi, this is Karin Sony, and you're listening to me on Geek to Me Radio. Lucky you.
Don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I'm rocking my pants.
Welcome back to Geek to Me Radio. I am your host, James Enstall. And this show would not be possible without the continued support of the City of St. Charles, the Greater St. Charles Convention and Visitors Bureau. You might know them by the website I frequently talk about, discoverstcharles.com. That's discoverstcharles.com. Always a lot going on in St. Charles. It's a great place to visit if you're a history buff, if you're a foodie, if you're looking for some unique shop to grab something for a gift for a friend coming up. These are all check marks you can put under St. Charles, the historic Main Street. The Greater St. Charles Convention and Visitors Bureau do a great job of showcasing all these great things. Go to the website and you'll kind of see what I mean, because they've got Instagram posts that they take from people who have visited St. Charles, and they've tagged St. Charles. You can do this too. If you visit, tag St. Charles, Discover St. Charles or Historic St. Charles for the hashtag on Instagram, and you might even see your picture featured in their banner there on the top of the website. Lots of things to do, lots of events. They've got their Legends and Lanterns coming on. I know with COVID, it's going to look a little different from years past if you've come out to visit, but that's what we are doing to keep all the patrons safe, to keep all the people participating safe. You can find out more about that event and all the other things there are to see and do. Once again, the website, Discover St. Charles. That's discoverstcharles.com. Before we went to break, we were chatting, as we are this whole hour, with DG Chichester, and we asked him if he has a favorite title or series that he worked on.
Yeah, and it's probably not going to be the one that's like the most in the sun, oddly enough. I mean, I did a lot of work with the Clive Barker universe at one point. You know, Clive Barker, the filmmaker and author and known for his dark fantasy and his horror work. And I had been well at the center of sort of bringing him over to some of the Marvel epic work that he did. In all honesty, it was because he wanted to work with Archie Goodwin, but I became sort of one of the main contacts and worked with him to editorialize the Hellraiser books. I wrote the Bible for that anthology.
Oh, wow.
So I worked with Clive to sort of go through, what does it mean when we take your novella and your movie concepts, and how do we translate those into comics? What's the comics universe, the comics world, that if we're going to give some rules to writers and artists and say, come write for our anthology, what are the ground rules? So we developed that together with a couple other people. And then I brought in the Nightbreed universe, which was one of his films. It was about like a group of monsters who were almost like mutants. We really started to think of them in a way that they're disenfranchised from the world. They have these fantastic abilities and powers. They're ostracized, misunderstood. And that was what the movie was sort of about. And we took that into comics, and I launched the comic movie adaptation. And working with Archie, we were able to get really A-list talent for that adaptation. And I'm sure you know, a lot of times movie adaptations, at least back in the day, maybe they're different now, but back in the day, a lot of times those were Z-list projects. They had to get out very quickly. They had to get out. No one really cared, big air quotes around that, in terms of, is this going to be the brightest, shiniest project? So they'd be done very quickly. They'd be done with whoever was available. And it was almost just, well, we licensed this, let's get it out the door. We took the Nightbreed assignment really seriously and got Alan Grant, John Wagner, on it to really blow it out of the water. Point being, my familiarity with those two books meant I worked on a lot of that Clive Barker stuff, and we came up with this thing called Jihad, which was the Nightbreed meet the Hellraiser characters. And It's a crossover that should never have worked. You know, it could have easily gone down the Aliens versus Predator road,
right,
of oh my God, you're doing another one and you're not making it work. But I was really proud as hell of what we did. We told a pretty solid story, a surprising story. Paul Johnson, who was the artist on it, was just incredible with what he brought to life. Very painterly, you know, electric style. Gregory Wright was the editor on it and let me go off the leash. And it was one of these projects that, because maybe I'd been working on all that other stuff for such a long time, I remember very much sitting down to frame the story out and it coming almost like automatic writing, you know, that sort of psychic phenomenon of like, you know, you almost feel like you're channeling the story. Like, where is this coming from? And so many lines and so many beats and so many things just came, you know, fluidly out of it. And you know, looking back on it even now, and I had to look it back on it recently because Boom Studios had put together a collection of a lot of the Nightbreed work, and that was included in there. So I went back and reread it. And sometimes rereading my stuff is, as I've said, sometimes like returning to the scene of the crime. You know, it's like,
sure,
God, what did I do? But that held up and holds up really well. And there was even instances in there where we really pushed possibly the limits on what we should be doing on a book that was going to have a Marvel, even Epic imprint. Mm-hmm. And I won't say going up against good taste, but we did push the boundaries. In fact, I remember very distinctly having an editorial meeting with Greg and Carl Potts, who was the executive editor over all of it. And Carl was like saying, "You want to do what?" And Carl is a great guy, but he was right to ask. And we explained how we were going to handle this scene and what it meant to the story, and that it did mean something to the story. So we had to defend what we were approaching. And he said, "Okay, I trust you guys." And overall, I think that holds up. I mean, I think a lot of things hold up, but that's a favorite if you're asking me. But you are.
It's interesting that nowadays, with all the graphic novels, and we're seeing things just brutal, no one would bat an eye at that now. And so it's kind of like, it feels, the way you're describing it, almost like you guys were breaking new ground in a way.
In a way. I mean, we were definitely, and it's funny because, you know, at the same time, Carnage was probably across the hall, you know, ripping open the intestines of small children and cackling over it. Not a big fan of Carnage, but
we'll see how Woody Harrelson does. We'll I'll reserve judgment.
Woody Harrelson, big thumbs up, you know. But you know, we were certainly trying to make it true to the stories and try to make it and the characters and the weirdness and the intent and purpose of what we felt Clive was trying to achieve. And we had lots of conversations with Clive as well. It was like he had final approval on books. He had approval on the stories. We were in conversations. We want to go in this direction. So how do you take what he was doing in some other mediums and recreate it in a new way and channel it forward? So in its own way, for its own universe, I'll go with breaking some new ground.
And with obviously, I would think, with Clive and then having someone like Alan on the book and everything, that kind of added some clout and they kind of were a little more, I guess, okay with giving you guys a little more space. Had you had just someone else on the book, it might not have flown as high, maybe?
Maybe. You know, Clive was was definitely a very respected and exciting figure among the fan base.
Yeah.
You'd go to a show, as you know, said before, and you'd sit there. The line would be around the convention floor and out the door, probably, for his body of work. And he was the sort of guy who'd sit there until every single person was done. You know, the lights are out, they're taking away the banners, and he's going to sit there and continue to engage with every single person. Internally, there was probably some weirdness around, okay, what are you guys in Epic doing nowadays? You know, you're bringing in this guy, we don't really know what he is. He's a little weirder than Stephen King. You know, he's Stephen King, who I love, is quote unquote safe, you know, in a way. Clive is definitely, you know, pushing things and going to stranger and darker and more uncomfortable places intentionally to try to push limits and push comfort levels, which is what maybe dark fantasy and and horror is supposed to do. It's not supposed to necessarily leave you feeling all clean and nice right. About certain things. So we definitely got some clout because we could say this guy is a best-selling author, a big filmmaker. He's got connections to all these different outfits where we can put him in front of things and we can leverage his name. But I don't know that his work was understood internally outside of some circles, right? Mm. Even all within the Epic world that I existed for a long time at Marvel, we were doing all the creator-owned work. We were doing a lot of eclectic work. Even the Marvel work that we were doing, like, say, Electro Assassin, Frank Miller and Bill Sienkiewicz's big book, which I was an assistant on. And I was an assistant editor on that one. I'll take that credit. and that's how I got to know Bill really well. To what you said before, maybe nowadays, maybe people wouldn't bat an eye at that. I think they probably still would to some extent. But at that time, that was like setting off a thermonuclear device.
Right.
That's not how Elektra looks. That's not how people talk in comics. What's all these points of view? What's Garrett doing? Why, so many things that were off the charts of normal in that, and yet was necessary to kind of explore territories. So internally, again, what are you guys doing?
So I collect, one of the things I collect comic book promo posters that were sent out to the shops.
Oh.
I'll find them on eBay and I'll take them. And if there's a convention, like I said, I try to do 6 conventions a year or thereabouts. I'll go to a convention just for the artist or the writer. So I get them to sign my poster and then I get them custom framed and hung on my wall. And I just got that Elektra Assassin poster. And I think Bill's work, I mean, is unmistakable. You see a piece of art and it's like, obviously, that's Sienkiewicz, and that's to have worked with him must have been an amazing experience because he's got such a unique perspective.
We're going to pause right there, come back, continue chatting with writer D.G. Chichester. Stand by.
Hey guys, this is Michael Rooker, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio. Have a good time.
Welcome back to Geek to Me Radio. I'm your host, James Enstall. Before we took that last commercial break, we were talking with D.G. Chichester, and we'd asked him about working with the just incredible artist, Bill Sienkiewicz.
Oh, yeah. He's a terrific guy and a terrific and continues to be a groundbreaking artist. And I worked with him on that very closely. And then his own book, which was Stray Toasters, I was the editor on that. And that was one where... as you said, his work was very unique. And as he was evolving his style between Elektra and that, he started to work and experiment with many more multidimensional mediums, not just the acrylic paints, but sometimes putting things on top of the page itself that were almost like 3D elements. So then we had to photograph those in a different way to capture them for publication. And they just continue to get larger and more elaborate. And I remember telling him at one point, listen, the day you drive one of these pages in here, I mean, it physically drops, not that you've driven it in your car, then we may have to have a talk.
Well, it might be a little hard to translate that if that was, driving it in. And you got to work, I know, co-creator of a character called Terror, which I still have that full run of that book, too. It was such a unique idea. So talk a little bit about coming up with the concept for that character.
Sure. And he would definitely be on that list of favorites, up there as well, because I did have a hell of a good time with him. And he was really unique. We had done a series of books called The Shadow Line, myself and a co-writer named Margaret Clark for Epic. And Archie Goodwin had at one point, Epic was doing these creator-owned comics. We were very proud of them. We were giving creators a chance to explore different and eclectic territory, but they weren't always the best-selling books. And that's fine. Everything doesn't have to sell here, but you want to explore what comics can do. And I'm very proud of what we were doing there, because I know that that's what we were giving established creators a chance to experiment with, or even new creators for that matter. Point being, Archie was also being strategic and said, if we had within Epic a line of heroes of our own, a little mini universe, maybe that would help give Epic a different identity and people would focus on it a little bit more. So he came up with these characters called the Shadows, and the Shadows were transhuman mutant sort of characters who had always existed within the confines of or the expanse of the world. Humans didn't know about them, but they had fantastic powers. Some were, as all things are, evil or good. And now there was a resurgence of them, and they were coming forward. So there was Powerline, which was two kids that existed when they got together. They sort of erupted in more power. There was Dr. Zero, who was a very Machiavellian manipulator of people and a very powerful character that Dennis Cowan was the artist on. And then there was a third one, which was called St. George. And St. George was a long history of knight-like characters. For some reason that I wish I had asked him, but I was just so dumbfounded at the moment, Archie gave me and Margaret the writing assignment on all three of them, which was like, why are you doing this? But I'm not going to say no at the same time, right? Amazing that somebody of his caliber would trust you to work on his books. And maybe that was it. Maybe from working together in his department, he had a sense we'd do good work. Anyway, long way around, St. George needed a villain at one point in one of the early issues. And I was writing with Margaret at that point in time. And I was actually just talking to Greg Wright about this the other day for something he was writing on Facebook. We needed a villain, and it was allergy season. And my eyes were burning. I mean, like the most terrible allergies possibly I've ever had. And I remember saying to Margaret, I would do anything if I could rip my eyeballs out of my skull, you know, and put them somewhere else while this is going on. And that was really that moment, as I said it, was like this, wait a minute, there's a villain in there, right? Because that was the essence of what the character we came up with, which was called Schreck, which is the German word for terror. And Schreck was his origin was within that St. George universe. So if you remember that character, his power was he could take other body parts from his victims and attach those parts to his body and then gain their memories, their physical powers. You know, if it was an engineer, his fingers could program something or create something. If he took the legs of somebody and they were a dancer, he could perform amazing choreography, whatever it was. So in that thinking about my own eyes, that's where we got the whole idea of that Schreck could take body parts from other people, put them into his own body. They would decompose over time, but for the initial thing, he could use their powers. So he became our main foil for Michael Devlin, who was the St. George character, and they had a lot of things going on, and everyone sort of liked the character. And at one point, when those Shadowline books ended, you know, sort of a big blowout, you know, finale, Carl Potts and I were talking, and Marvel was trying to come up with an idea to do something with all of their horror titles. You know, what could we do with, Man-Thing? What could we do with Werewolf by Night? How could we bring them together maybe under an umbrella of some kind? And somebody in editorial to come up with the idea of maybe that Schreck character could be a focus, you know, a focal point to bring them together. So that's when we said, maybe we'll bring this character, same kind of look, same kind of power base. We're going to rename him Terror because, as I said, Schreck was Terror. We're going to bring him over into the Marvel Universe, and he's going to play this role. Well, we had started working on that, and then that whole idea went away. You know, they weren't going to do that with bringing all the dark characters together. But we had begun work on what would this guy be? What would he do in the Marvel Universe? And for some crazy reason, they said, well, why don't you just turn it into a book? Why don't you just make it his own self-standing title? And so that's what we did. It unfortunately didn't get the promotional things it was sort of promised. So I think it was a little bit under the radar. Some of the other books that were launched at the same time got their special scratch and sniff covers and, you know, their holograms and things. Right. And unfortunately we didn't get the sort of silly boost that we were promised. And I think that may have hurt, some of the initial boost that it might've gotten. So it only lasted for, I think, about 10 or 13 issues. Could be off on that, but we got some great reviews. I remember one review, was there's nothing else like this in the Marvel Universe. And that's pretty great.
Yeah.
And so I had a ball, and I mean, working with Jorge Zavino on that that first run of that book. I mean, that guy was a fierce, fierce talent and really a terrific, terrific experience.
And there's a lot of those 90s characters who kind of made their debut. Then they're kind of coming back a little bit. I know we're seeing a little bit more of Darkhawk and stuff like that. So I was kind of surprised they haven't kind of looked at that and said, huh, because it was such an original concept. And like I said, I really enjoyed the book that they haven't kind of thought about, especially now with comics kind of being a little more edgy, with them kind of bringing terror back. I think it'd be kind of cool.
And we'll take our next break, come back and get those thoughts from DG Chichester. Please stand by.
Hello, everyone. This is Paul Soles, voice of Spider-Man and Ermy the Misfit Elf, wanted to be a dentist on Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Coming to you on Geek to Me Radio. Hope you enjoy. Talk with you soon.
Here comes the Spider-Man.
Welcome back to Geek to Me Radio. I'd like to make sure to mention our other sponsor, Marcus Theaters. MarcusTheaters.com is the website. They've been really good about keeping us busy while we've been missing movies during COVID. They've got the snack pack that you can be sent to your home. Huge, and I mean huge, bag of popcorn along with a little popcorn tub that you can refill when you bring that back once the theaters open. And they are starting to slowly open back up again. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, the St. Charles Cinema will be open August 21st. And I think they're opening a few more. They're opening Ronnie's, Chesterfield, I believe DePere, and Arnold, there may be another one the following weekend on the 28th. All done safely. They're doing social distancing. There'll be seats you can't buy, obviously. Limited capacity on the movies. And you'll be required to wear the masks. So they're putting the safety. And again, everyone's not going to be ready to go back. And we get that. And so does Marcus. That's why they're still allowing you to do a lot of these things from home, like the Marcus Theater Pack I was just describing with the huge movie-sized fun candies they'll send to your house to give you that movie experience at home. I'm ready to get back in theaters. Movies are something I love, and I can't wait to see Tenet and some of these other films that will be coming out here as we end the summer. Kind of a weird summer to not have blockbusters, but Marcus Theaters has been doing everything they can to make sure that we still have that movie experience, be it from their parking lot drive-in events that they've been doing. You can check out the website, MarcusTheaters.com, to find information, what theaters open by you, what the status of their opening is, if they're doing the drive-in or if they're doing actual openings, screenings. You can get the tickets. MarcusTheaters.com. Very appreciative to have them with us throughout 2020 here as we press on. Before we took our last break, we were talking with writer D.G. Chichester and asked him his thoughts about bringing Terror or Terror Inc. back.
There was two short series that I was not involved with, and I want to say was it David Latham that might have done them, and I'm probably wrong, but I could be right.
I'll look it up. I've actually
and so there were two, David Latham did two short spin-off series using the character. I have not read them. They didn't ask me to be involved, which I thought was a little bit of a, weird thing that they didn't even like give me a tap on the shoulder or something.
Yeah.
But I did contact them and say, oh, if you're running these books, make sure you get the credit line right. You know, created by myself and Margaret Clark and Klaus Janson, who created the original design for the character. So I don't know where they went with that. And I assume it wasn't, didn't take off, but I think it is. I've sometimes toyed with the idea of contacting like Tom Brevoort or somebody at Marvel and sort of saying, listen, this is probably not going to fit with your Disney Masters point of view. I don't expect to see a Netflix fit, thing about this guy, but maybe, who knows? But it is something. It's one of those really weird, unique characters. And I remember talking to Carl Potts at one point saying, well, geez, if Marvel's not going to do anything with this, maybe I'll just like recreate the character somebody else. And he laughed and said, well, your problem here is that you gave this guy such a weird, unique ability. Like it's not just, oh, here's another set of claws or here's another big, big, bulky, strong guy. No matter where you go with him, people are going to know exactly what it is.
It's very true.
Your own worst enemy, he said.
And it's, I was wondering, too, because you've got a background in film, obviously. Went to school to study that. And then you it sounds like you really enjoy horror. If you were to, with the Marvel Cinematic Universe and everything like that, let's say they come to you and say, hey, we're going to actually try doing either a, direct to the, I don't know if the Disney Plus, but let's say they're doing a movie and they're going to cast terror. Do you have in your mind, because I imagine writers, when they're doing this thing, they have to kind of have that little bit see. Do you have an actor who you think would be perfect for the part?
Wow. That's, that's something, because Klaus was such a fierce, artist in his own right. You know, once you sort of see that eyeball and those weird spikes and all that sort of stuff coming out of the face, we didn't, and I don't think we defined those things. You know, he had certainly the rotting part, but probably not the spikes, or he just sort of added those. I would say, we probably didn't have, somebody in mind, but like thinking of, who would it be? Who would it be now? That's a really good, give me a second. Let me think about that.
And obviously, we've had Josh Brolin as Thanos, so you don't have to worry about the look per se, because it's going to be all CGI'd and everything like that anyway, prosthetics. Yeah, but so it just like the voice or the demeanor or anything like that.
I mean, I would love a Willem Dafoe or a Jeremy Irons. Irons. In the sense of either one of those, because he was a very, he wasn't necessarily necessarily evil character, but his catch line, if you will, was, nothing personal, it's just business. Right. I mean, he was a businessman. It was Terror Incorporated. It was a business as an assassin and a mercenary. So I think when you're thinking about quality of voice and delivery and that sort of, I'm ageless and above it all, and yet I can project, a sense of menace. Either one of those voices strike me as something that would really carry the day with that, if we were able to bring a character like that to life.
Yeah, that'd be cool to see. And I know we talking again about the Marvel Cinematic Universe and Netflix, having had such an indelible impact on Daredevil as you have had, did you enjoy the Netflix series? Obviously, they ended up taking down Kingpin in the third season. Did you watch it? Is it kind of something you paid attention to? What were your feelings?
I was all over that like nobody's business. and it was probably a wonderful thing because, in the sense of not quite validation, but it was definitely the point where my son, who's now 19, was finally coming around. When he was younger and I said, hey, your dad used to write comics, he was like, whatever, nothing. Reality check. Great, great stuff. Daredevil was a terrific point in time where it's like an understanding of you had an influence on this character. You worked on this and definitely I became a little bit more of a cool dad, in that moment in time. And there was something, I thought the whole thing was just so well executed and such a heartbreak for it to expire and go away. And I was talking to my son yesterday, and we're holding out hope beyond hope that Spider-Man's legal troubles in the next Spider-Man movie, that a blind lawyer shows up to defend him, and that they cast, Charlie Cox him in, even if it's just a cameo, right? If it's just like a little, like, doesn't even have to become Daredevil in the movie. If Charlie Cox was to show up and say, I'm your court-appointed lawyer, the audience would lose its shit,
exactly.
Right? We would just, it would be like, Avengers Assemble or Cap catching the hammer for those folks. But I thought it was so incredibly well executed, and the ferocity, right, of the hallway fight, the stairway fight, the prison fight, those extended scenes that they became those high watermarks, were really just, oh my God, this is the character. This is what we tried to capture. Sometimes we did capture in that sense of who he is. And it's funny watching it, saying to myself, yeah, Matt Murdock really isn't that great a lawyer in some ways.
Right.
Because, he's translated himself. Foggy's an awesome lawyer. And I think they just hit so many great things, and the way they visualized the hyper senses, it was something I always tried to do. I always tried to play out the senses in different, sometimes well-written things, sometimes overwritten things. But I always played with the senses a lot. And I thought that was a really interesting thing to sort of see that come forward the way that they played it out was really interesting. And while I didn't get, one of those nice little thank yous in the credits, nor did I expect one, because they didn't lift anything directly, there was the moment where that costume showed up, where they did have a bit more of the assembled effect around it.
Yeah.
And I shot a note to Scott McDaniel, you know, right after it was over, and I said, validate it, you know, because when we had recreated the costume in the Fall from Grace storyline, you know, we took a lot of grief for it. And when Scott drew that costume, it was always very fluid. You know, the whole backstory behind it was he was facing ferocious characters. He needed more protection, which was essentially what Daredevil was saying in the show. I need something more than this hoodie and gloves. And that was, you know, we weren't saying he's suddenly going to become an armored character. We were saying he and it's not that he's weaker or he's less of a daredevil. It's common sense. It's practical. And we had all these ideas around the materials and the biomimetic, you know, things he was stealing or using to kind of create the costume in the comic. So to see that kind of assembly, I felt very much like, all right, somebody's if they're not name checking us, or maybe they didn't even look at our books, our thought process was not off.
No, yeah, so. Absolutely. That's one of the things I thought, that the costume was a nice midway point between his straight red costume and the armored look, which honestly, I'll tell you, I'm such a huge fan of the armored look that you guys did. I actually talked to a guy, I don't do a lot of cosplay, but I commissioned him. I'm like, I never see that Daredevil cosplay at a convention. So I talked to a guy about commissioning the armored look, because nobody else will have that look. So kudos to you, because I still, to this day, love that look of Daredevil.
And we'll take our last break for this segment, come back and finish this half of our talk with writer D.G. Chichester. Stand by.
This is Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Welcome back to the show. Wrapping things up for this segment. We will have more, the second part of my interview with D.G. Chichester, on next week. It was too good to cut this conversation, folks. I love talking to him. Great guy. We had a lot to discuss, so I wanted to, rather than try to cut parts of it out, we're going to have another part coming to you next week as well, so make sure you tune in for that. Before we took that last break that we were chatting, we wrapped up this episode talking about, I love the look, Daredevil's 90s armor look.
If you get that going, I'd love to see how that turns out. I think much as I was saying, like with Carl, like sort of saying, well, you came up with a character you can't take anywhere else. I think the problem, in the air quotes, you know, around that costume was, it turned out the only person who could really draw it well was Scott. Because when Scott drew it, you know, he made it very fluid.
Yeah.
You know, he made it feel like it was very much part of the body and the shape of how he'd move and, you know, jump and all these things. And unfortunately, when anybody else drew it, I think they just came into thinking about, well, it's armor, right? And they would bulk it up and they would bolt it up and they would. And I did a story later with Lee Weeks. It was the final Daredevil story, the final volume one story. They'd asked Tim Tui, he'd asked Lee and I to come back and sort of end the series, which was amazing.
Yeah.
Before it went to volume two. And that whole story was a riff on different people around New York's impression of Daredevil. And I did one comical scene in there where the villain seeing Daredevil kept seeing him in a more and more outrageously armored costume to sort of drive that point home. Like, it was never supposed to be armor.
Right.
It was just a different construction. And I think they nailed that idea in the series, the Netflix series, so very well.
And they've got, I know, Toy Biz, when they had the Marvel license and they first started doing those Marvel superheroes lines, they actually did a variant of Daredevil that has the armor. Do you have that figure in your collection proudly displayed?
I do. Hang on one second.
For those of you who are listening at home, this is the first time I've done visual Skype, so I'm actually getting to see the things that Dan has in his background here. This is great. Yes!
Grappling hook action.
Yes!
That was one of the ones I remember running around to, like, when I heard it was out, running around to, what was it, like, probably like KB Toys.
Yeah, you know, exactly.
And finding it. I think it was like the only place that was like carrying it. So, and that's, that will never come out. I'm not like much of like a keep the toys in the package sort of guy, but this one will never come out.
Oh, I know. Yeah. That one you have to. And I will say, it's interesting the point you made. I hadn't thought about Scott having drawn it so well, because it obviously the fact that I didn't think about it shows how seamless it was throughout the two of your run on that book. But I love the cover. One of my favorite, probably my favorite Spider-Man artist is Mark Bagley. And he did a cover of, I think it was Amazing Spider-Man 396, that has the armored Daredevil and Spider-Man side by side. And that's actually, he did a great job for that cover too. Just kind of, as I'm thinking outside the box, other artists who attempted the look.
That makes sense. I mean, Bagley's style is a very fluid style in its own way. And his Spider-Man is very extended, you know, if I'm thinking it in the right way. So it would make a lot of sense that he would get it intuitively or because he's thinking it through. And as I said, sometimes it was never within the Daredevil book itself necessarily, but certainly places where he would show up in other scenes or posters or whatever. And suddenly it was this very bulked up, just type of look that just allowed people to say, oh, Daredevil shouldn't have armor. We hate this costume. And they're absolutely right. Daredevil should not have armor per se. And that wasn't what it was meant to be. But you learn by doing.
Just don't let Rob Liefeld get a hold of it. It'll be all armor and pouches. That'll be all that you can see.
That's what we should have added. We should have had a scene with a pouch Daredevil. Yeah,
it was 90s. It could have happened. You never know.
Exactly.
I just want to make a quick note here. We've been at it for about 40 minutes. Are you okay? I don't want to take up too much of your morning. If you need to wrap up soon.
No. You tell me what you want to talk about. I'm yours for... You haven't cut me off at 10 minutes, so it's at least interesting enough for you to keep talking. So hit what you want. I'm here for you.
I love, like I said, this is why I kind of started the show, because I get to fanboy out and actually talk to the people who did all these work on people who I love, the, like I said, Terror and Daredevil and everything like that. I'm a huge fan, so this is great for me.
Thank you.
That's one of the reasons I started the radio show, so it's kind of helpful in that respect.
That's going to do it for this particular episode. We will get to more with DG Chichester next week. Please make sure you're subscribing to us. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Geek2Me Radio. My thanks, as always, to Joey V for making this sound as good as it does. There's nobody better in the business when it comes to producing. Until next week, my friends.
It's not in the way you watch I sound be. It's not
Thank you, Hell's Kitchen. Good night.
Hi, this is James Enstall, host of Geek to Me Radio, and in honor of my favorite Themyscirian, I've decided to become an Amazon warrior.
Hera, give me strength.
The next time you want to buy something from Amazon, go to geektomeradio.com first and click on our Amazon affiliate link. Simply shop like you normally would, and when you check out, a small percentage will go towards supporting the show. So remember, the next time you want to search Amazon for the latest Wonder Woman graphic novel or parts for your invisible jet... click through from geektomeradio.com first.
The world was in peril. Would you have me stand by and do nothing?